Welcome to Upthinking Finance, a podcast that offers a unique and discerning view of economics and financial planning. Here is your host, Emerson Fersh.
Welcome to another episode of Upthinking Finance. I want to start today's episode with a quote that has traditionally been attributed to a 19th century British philosopher named Herbert Spencer, but likely has its derivation from writings of a 18th century British theologian named William Paley. And the quote is, "There is a principle which is a bar against all information, which is proof against all arguments, and which cannot fail to keep a man in everlasting ignorance. That principle is contempt prior to investigation." A few weeks ago, I interviewed Dr. Michael Rechtenwald, who he and I discussed on an episode called The Not-So-Great Reset, this globalist movement, this move to a new world order, and the organization that's really behind it, which is the World Economic Forum. We spent some time talking about the role of global corporations, particularly those in the finance industry. And he tried to address a concern I've had since I really started to understand this, which is why financial companies that exist ostensibly to help, you know, my clients and everybody else build wealth would be connected to an organization who has a mission that we own nothing by 2030 and we're happy, that we rent everything we need and it's delivered by drones, and that, you know, we eat bugs and we are tracked in pretty much all aspects of our daily life. And so I want to start this episode today with just a follow-up on that, and I want to illustrate something to you, and I'm going to ask those of you who are listening, if you want later, you can go to our YouTube channel, which is Upthinking Finance. But I'm going to share with you and just my screen, and I want to show everybody something who's watching, illustrate the point. And this is to just explain to you just how deep these globalist companies are in terms of their influence in our economy. Now, I just pulled up Exxon Mobil stock, and I want to say that all I'm doing is illustrating points here. I'm not making recommendations. This isn't applicable to anything other than me to illustrate a point. Now, you go to the holders, and what this will show you is who owns the company stock. And you can see Vanguard, BlackRock, and State Street are the top three owners of Exxon Mobil stock. And they control 20% of the voting rights because they own 20% of the publicly traded stock. This is important because, as you may recall, Dr. Rechtenwald talked about this ESG, which is kind of a forced compliance with the objectives and philosophy of the World Economic Forum. Let's try another one. Let's go to Starbucks, a company everybody's familiar with for one reason or another. And same thing. Whoops. That's what happens when you click too fast. We go to holders of the stock. And once again, about close to 20% of the stock is owned by Vanguard, BlackRock, and State Street. And you can see a few other World Economic Forum supporters are here in the top part of the list. Bank of America, Royal Bank of Canada, and Morgan Stanley. Let's try one more. How about Procter & Gamble? That's a company that provides a lot of, you know, household things that we use on a day-to-day basis. And once again, no surprise, you know, again, 20% of the stock controlled by Vanguard, BlackRock, and State Street. Morgan Stanley in there again. And J.P. Morgan, which is another company that's affiliated with this movement. So the reason why I bring this up is because it's clearly not our imagination what's going on. These companies control the stock of a number of publicly traded companies, and because of that have the ability to influence how they run their business, who they include on their board, a lot of things. So this is important because you could look at this and think, well, how do you unwind something like this? And, you know, how do we stand a chance, you know, to have a free market system when these companies have this kind of influence? Well, today's guest I've invited on mainly because he believes that the Davos crowd, which is what he calls the World Economic Forum group and all the elites and political people that are associated with it, he believes they're losing the battle. So today's guest, his name is Tom Luongo. He's a former research chemist. He's an amateur dairy goat farmer. And as he refers to himself, he's an anarcho-libertarian and obstreperous Austrian economist. His work can be found in a lot of places. It's published on Zerohedge, LouRockwell.com, Bitcoin Magazine, and Newsmax Media. He also is the owner and publisher of the Gold, Goats, and Guns newsletter and podcast. And here he provides a forum where he attempts to connect the false narrative that is typically tied to geopolitical events and tries to develop them into a viable long-term investment thesis. He lives in Florida with his wife of 30 years and his teenage daughter. And I'll say for me, in a world where many independent journalists are emerging as the only reliable source of unbiased information, for me, Tom Luongo stands out not only for his knowledge and analysis of geopolitical events, but really for his ability to communicate this in a very simple and understandable way.
So it's my pleasure to introduce live from Florida, Mr. Tom Luongo. Tom, thanks for joining me today on Upthinking Finance.
Sure. Thanks for having me.
Before we get started, we do have a couple things in common. I know I read somewhere you're a big hockey fan. Can I ask you who you follow?
I used to be a big hockey fan. I now just don't have time for it anymore, but I'm a long-suffering Buffalo Sabres fan. So I used to actually write a Sabres blog in the before time, right after the lockout. And I actually worked for AOL as a fan house for a while back in like 2008, 2009. When sports blogging became a thing back then, I was there as along with a bunch of other guys. We were kind of the first generation hockey bloggers. So, and we all got picked up by AOL and tried to do it professionally. And then we all went, there's no money in this. And we left and we went and got real jobs. So
not enough time for hockey. Well, you know, it might be a good time to pick up. Buffalo's starting to look like they may be turning the corner. So,
well, let's see. You know, they've been trying to turn the corner. I keep my hand in it. I look every year and I'm like, well, yeah, no. Like the front office is a mess. Since they got rid of Darcy Brashear, the front office has been a mess. So
I'm a Blues fan, and it's
been that's fine. Cool. Like, yeah. I don't mind the Blues. I don't hate them, so that's fine. You know, you're not a Red Wings fan. You're not a Maple Leafs fan. You're not a Rangers fan. You're good. Like we can have a conversation now. It's all good. It's all good now.
And then the other thing is we have a mutual friend in Alex Craner, which we were talking about earlier. And for the listeners, this is a new endeavor for me. Alex was my first interview, and he was also Tom's first interview when he started his podcast. So so we have a good foundation to build on. So let me start with this. I became aware of this globalist movement, I'm going to call it, in the World Economic Forum probably a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. And to me, I've really looked at the global financial structure as that's my focus of where to put some blame, because I can't get past this idea that, you know, these big companies that are supposed to be helping people accumulate wealth are, you know, basically connected to an organization who wants everybody to own nothing. It doesn't, you know, make sense to me. So, but in listening to the talk you just gave at the Ron Paul Institute, you know, last month, it sounds like I may be looking at, as I think you put it, one side of the board. And I guess I'd like to start by saying, if there's somebody that we can, something or someone we can look at as the enemy, who would that be if that even exists?
It has to be. I identified it in that talk, and I've worked on this idea for years. It's really the Davos meme is really mine. I started calling them Davos like 5 years ago, and it just kind of kept creeping slowly. And now I see Laura Ingraham use the term Davos on Fox News. I'm like, oh, okay, her staff reads my work. Got it. Which is good. I don't care about the credit or anything along those lines. I just know that if you seed truth into the zeitgeist, it tends to propagate. Right. So we'll start there. And the problem with Davos is, as a concept, is that it was easy to identify who the globalists were back in 2015 or 2016. Like watching them coalesce around all hating Donald Trump or all being against Brexit, it was easy. And it was on both sides of the Atlantic. It was on all sides of the political spectrum here in the United States. It was on, you know, it was all over Europe. Any populist movement, right, that sprung up in Hungary or France or Italy or the UK or the United States was immediately branded far right, was immediately branded as persona non grata in the polite society, for lack of a better term. And this mostly comes from, I've identified, it comes from the people centered around the World Economic Forum, around Davos. And I mean, it's bigger than that. It's more ancient than that. It goes all the way back to the Bank of England and the rest of it. But for today's purposes, right, it really does center on the old European colonialist interests who control the European banking system and the City of London banking system. Now, that's been co-opted. For years, we had the American banking system working along with them. So everybody was on board with the globalist plan to bank to extract wealth from the world. Well, that system was solvent, right? So JP Morgan went along with it. Goldman Sachs went along with it. They were, you know, everybody here in the United States went along with it. That system broke in 2008 when Lehman Brothers fell. The dollar reserve standard broke in 2008, right? And it, I didn't identify it then at the time. I've only identified it in hindsight recently. That I think that the end of the dollar reserve standard happened when Lehman Brothers broke. And then we had a period of what we call this coordinated central bank era of monetary policy.
And I remember you and Alex were talking about this.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's the question, because see, my thought, and I imagine most people that have enough awareness of this to just be dangerous, I suppose, mm-hmm. is you've got the good guys and the bad guys. And I know that it's very blurry.
Yeah, no, it's very blurry.
And so my take was, from your conversation, that, you know, the Davos crowd, as you call them, is actually losing this battle.
I think so.
Okay, so everybody's going along lowering rates globally from, like you said, 2011. Is it just simply, again, as a financial advisor looking at this stuff, that the rates just got too low and eventually, you know, you have nowhere else to go?
Well, yeah. The ECB destroyed, as Martin Armstrong has pointed out many, many times, the ECB destroyed the euro as potential reserve currency replacement for the dollar by going to negative interest rates, right? Who the hell wants to hold European sovereign debt at minus 0.8%? Nobody. So now we have a situation where they had to go there because the European banks were structurally unsound, right? But they were able to get away with it because they had a compliant Fed who was feeding money through ZERP. And the carry trades were feeding that into everybody to allow for the ECB to get away with all this for years. And the Bank of Japan and even the SNB, who then over the course of the last 15 years has turned into the world's largest equity hedge fund, right?
So are you saying that Powell, because to me, he's just a part of the government, which is a part of the problem. I mean, effectively.
Sure. It's a nice and simple way of looking at things, but yeah. it's not that way.
Okay, so this is what I want to ask you. Explain to me what's going on, because I see that these articles. There was something written, I think, yesterday that, you know, if you put us into recession, you know, it's going to be your fault, Powell.
Sure.
You know,
that's the current Davos meme of the day. As a matter of fact, that's the blog post I'm literally writing right now. None dare call it a recession, lest the Democrats lose the midterms. Like literally, it should be out this afternoon. But certainly by the time this interview posts. So then now they're trying to redefine recessions and everything else. It's just hilarious watching them do this personally. But here's the thing. What Davos wants is the imposition, is a way to repudiate all of the debt and all of the broken promises of all of the social safety nets that have been put into place over the last 75 years, right? Europe is broke. Their banks are broke. Their governments are broke. They can't pay their pensions. They can't pay any of this stuff. We're broke here. We're technically broke here in the United States for many of the same reasons. Everybody within kind of alternative crank finance space has been saying this for years. Anybody who reads Zerohedge even remotely sympathetically understands the structure of the argument. It's not particularly difficult. If you have any experience with Austro-Libertarian thinking on these matters, even if you're just not quite down with the Keynesianism, like even Keynesianism has failed, right? Like even Keynes is rolling over in his grave as to what we're doing at this point, right? So, but here's the thing. All of that was fine as long as you were going to have a perpetuation of the current some form of the commercial banking system, right? This is the problem. Central bank digital currencies obviate the need for central banks. Now everybody, as opposed to having accounts at PNC and let them do the, or JP Morgan or any of your regional banks or your local credit union or whatever, right? Any of those, all of those don't need to exist anymore because people can just go directly to the central bank to get their loan or not get their loan, not get their money because, well, they ate a pizza the other night and, you know, you're fat and you don't deserve to get a car loan now because, you know, well, we don't like cars. So this week we don't like cars. So you're not allowed to get a car loan. And then next week you're not going to be able to, you know, order pizza because you're fat. Like the social credit score is real. Christine Lagarde has talked about this in explicit terms when she was the head of the IMF. before she became, before she was installed by Klaus Schwab to be the head of the ECB, after she, after he moved Mario Draghi out of the ECB and into the prime ministership over in Italy.
Change of seats. I've noticed that too.
Yeah, no, this is very important. This is why last year I said, hey, when they decide to get rid of Biden, they're going to put Janet Yellen in as president, because, you know, why not?
Why not?
So, because, you know, it just fits the MO.
Right.
So if you want to, if your goal is to do away with the central banks, institute world government through the UN and have the IMF be the world central bank, because the IMF, as Jim Rickards has told us for years, putting this together, that when the central banks go bust, only the IMF will have the capital to bail everybody out.
Okay.
So that's been the plan. Now, whether you think Jim is compromised in any way, because he's, you know, he does work with the CIA and the DOD on you know whatnot, or whether he's telling us, you know, a version of the truth, which is where I tend to fall on with Jim. I think he likes to tell us about 75% of the truth. If you parse all that together, it's pretty obvious that the goal here is exactly that. Now, if you're the New York boys, you're Goldman, you're Morgan, you're Citigroup, right, you're Wells, and you're the shareholders in the New York Federal Reserve, are you going to go along with this?
So basically, if I'm getting this right, one thing is you're saying that these big wealth management firms that I've personally tried to avoid to the extent you can, just on basis of principle alone.
Sure. Fair enough.
Are on the partner list on the World Economic Forum site by name only. That the evidence that this thing is failing is just what you described, that they're realizing that they're tied to this organization at some point. Maybe they were going to be a part of in some kind of global distribution channel, whatever. They're realizing they're getting cut out. Is that a fair way?
Yeah, I just think it's like everything else. Like at some point, everybody's on. We're all hockey fans, right? What cures all problems in the room? Winning. What happens when they start losing?
Yeah.
Okay. Now the fingers start getting pointed. Now what happens when one group attempts to predate the other group? Every cartel is metastable. Like this is a classic free market, classic free market analysis of cartel or the cartelization of a market. At some point, the cartel breaks down because the cartel's rules don't work for some individual members. And therefore, at some point, those rules, they will go along with it for as long as it is not existential to their future. Like leaving the cartel is existential, because the cartel will come down on them like a ton of bricks and destroy them. Right. But there comes a point when the cartel is now weak enough that one can break away and then collapse the cartel. Well, if we had a cartel of central banks all happily coordinating, and one of them, the most powerful one in the world, who was the one getting the most screwed by the globalist policy, who was the one who they were using, Austro-libertarians like ourselves, as the main gadflies to explain why the Fed is the bad guy. I love Dr. Paul, like, with a purple passion. He's an immense figure in American history. But end the Fed, while a great piece of marketing, is also very dangerous, because it's now been used to co-opt to make the Fed the villain for the entire world. When Europe is over there sitting there going, we want our colonies back, and you know, we control Fed policy, and we can make them look like the bad guys. We can have them bail out everybody, print all this money, and then allow all the first order, you know, gold bugs and hard money analysts to go, yeah, see, the Fed's terrible. Like, and then stop, because they think they've unlocked the keys to the candy store. They think they have the Rosetta Stone to global politics and global economics, and they don't. It's far more complicated than that. And I used to be one of these people. Like, it was easy. Like, the world was so much easier when it was just, hey, just buy gold and wait these people out. But it's not that simple. When the time horizon here is, oh, what, we're gonna have to wait till 2040 for me to finally get paid on my gold positions? Like, I'm gonna be dead by then. Like, it was one thing to do this stuff when I was just some dude, but the minute I got hired by Newsmax to write a financial newsletter on the monthly basis, and I had to give people good advice, like, the thesis started to break down really quickly for me. And I within about a year, 18 months or so, I ran into a real, right in the middle of, this is 2013 to 2015, I'm running into a real problem because I'm like, this isn't making any sense. I'm wrong. Now, how do I extricate myself from this? And where am I going to become right? And that's when I had to start embracing arguments about, no, the dollar is going to strengthen at some point. Europe is the problem. The dollar is not the, you know, I had to give up my, you know, I have criticisms like we all do of the American system, but we have to give that up and go, is that really the only discussion? This is why I get angry with my compatriots in geopolitics. They're all, you know, fervently anti-American to the point of losing their reason. And I'm like, no, Europe is the problem. They've always been the problem. They've always been the issue. They've always been the people behind the wars and the central and central bank policy and everything else. Because guess what? They're colonialists and they're commies. It's not hard. Communism is a European idea, as Putin reminded us six months ago at the beginning of the year at a speech at Valdai. Like, and you people exported it to us and nearly destroyed it with us, and we don't want it again. You guys have fun with that.
That's a bit of a minority view, though.
Very minority view.
I was going to say that was one of the things that drew me to you. Is like, this is a whole new take I haven't really heard.
Right.
Resonates. So now, on the subject of Europe, because I know again in some of your writings, you've mentioned that basically there's evidence that they're starting to fall apart. I guess simple way of me putting it. But then if you're but then another way I look at this, I say, okay, what's his name? What, Merkel's gone, but you got this Schultz guy back in, who's just another, world.
Schultz is a captured pawn. Yeah, he's a captured pawn of the Greens. The Greens were put in power in Germany. They actually run the German government.
Well, then you've got this Rishi Sunak, who looks to be the heir apparent for Johnson, who is another World Economic Forum minion. So to me, it's just okay, out with the old, in with the new. So could you really elaborate, because I think you have a great handle on this, of where to look to see.
Yeah, now this is complicated. Like, the Russians very smartly realized that the war in Ukraine was going to turn into a war of attrition. The question is, who's war and who's attrition? All right. We were thinking we seriously underestimated Russia's financial and economic prowess by just looking at raw GDP numbers and thinking, oh, well, they have the GDP of Canada. Well, that's nice. In purchasing power parity terms, they have the GDP that's greater than Germany's. When you look at the structure of the Russian economy, when you break it down by production and services, it's more of a production economy than a service economy. So they produce a whole lot. Their GDP actually makes things, like bullets and bombs and rockets and oil and gas and tarmac and copper and titanium and wheat and pigs and fish and all the rest of this stuff, right? Whereas we produce financialization, we make money on money. How much of our economy, I've been saying this for years, how much of our economy is actually a froth based on the size of the credit markets, and how much of Europe's is a function of the offshore euro dollar shadow banking system? Ooh, that's a big one.
Do you remember that article right after these sanctions? It was on Zerohedge, and I honestly had no idea, but they put out what the impact was going to be of what Russia brought to the world economy. Because you never,
never thought of it.
You don't think about Russia.
I did.
Player. Okay, I know you.
I've been doing this for 10 years, Emerson. Like, dead serious. I first put Gazprom in my portfolio for my newsletter in 2014.
Well, okay, so remember, I'm a guy who's been influenced by all the usual names over the years, and took what they said as some kind of gospel. And so that was the big revelation to me. And you see this fertilizer and all this other stuff you're talking
fertilizer,
about.
Fertilizer, titanium. I wrote an article back in 2017 saying the Russians have, when the first next round of sanctions went through, I said Russia has the sanctions hammer. They own the controlling share of the entire uranium upstream through downstream market. FYI, like, they build more nuclear power plants than everybody. They, between their relationship with Kazakhstan, they produce more yellow cake than everybody else, and they process upwards of 50% of the world's uranium from U-308 into usable fuel, into single work units, or whatever they're called, SWUs. So do the math, and the Russians control the uranium market. Now look at Europe. Now let's talk about this. If the Russian economy produces, you know, three in purchasing power parity dollars, $3 trillion a year worth of stuff people want, as opposed to the $1.7 trillion in depreciated rubles, which were held way lower than they needed to be because of sanctions. The ruble trading in the 70s was like, it was retarded, frankly. I know I'm not supposed to use that word, but I'm sorry, it was. At $100 a barrel oil, to see the Russian ruble trading in the 70s was just dumb. But because it should have been trading back in the 40s or the 50s, like it was previous to the 2014 ruble crisis. And when it was trading, when oil was $125 a barrel, the ruble was trading at 32 to the dollar. People forget this. And then it hit 80 when the price of oil crashed in late 2014. And when Putin allowed the ruble to free float, you know, I said, they're going to survive this. The ruble's going to free float. They'll be fine. They're going to pay all their bills in rubles, and, you know, they don't care. And now they can truly express their cost of production, which is around $9 a barrel. Okay. FYI. Out of the ground, $9 a barrel.
Compared to what? Like 30 over here? Is that
what? Oh, like 50.
Okay.
And for budgetary reasons, because the Saudis have the real pegged to the dollar and their budget, now the Saudis need $80 a barrel. Or $70 a barrel. MBS is trying to get Mohammed bin Salman is trying desperately to get them out of that. It's what Vision 2040 plan and all that stuff he's talking about, modernizing the Saudi economy, is all about. But, you know, back then the Saudis tried to, you know, were working with the Americans to basically take market share from the Russians, and it didn't work. And then eventually the Saudis had to go and sue for peace, allow Russia into OPEC as a part of OPEC Plus. And now Russia and the Saudi Arabians control the price of oil, marginal price of oil, and OPEC's production quotas. And OPEC is stronger today than it ever was, because all the oil producers understand that Davos, Europe, the West, however you want to put it, is now hostile to the concept of oil, thanks to global warming. So what are they trying to do? They're trying to decarbonize the economy. Well, they're actually trying to decarbonize the world by getting rid of humans, but that's a completely different. That's a tangential issue. That's a tangential issue. Let's just like look at the situation. Yeah. So, but when you understand this is the totality of their plan. And so at the end of the day, you know, even if you have a very dim view of people like Jamie Dimon, and, you know, it's John Solomon, I think, is the head of is the CEO over Goldman now. So I think that's his name. What's that?
Larry Fink.
No, Larry Fink. No, Larry Fink is a different. He's in Davos crap.
Okay.
Larry Fink is pure Davos. But if you look at the guys within, I've identified, having talked to some market professionals and just watched their statements and whatnot over the course of the last couple of years, it's Jamie Dimon over at JP Morgan, Goldman, Wells, and Citigroup are all off the Davos train. Bank of New York Mellon on the Davos train. Morgan Stanley on the Davos train, right? Who's the other one that I'm missing? BOFA, definitely on the Davos train. Everybody who showed up for Davos this year, right? Brian Moynihan, Larry Fink, all those guys showed up at Davos 2022 this year to listen to George Soros tell everybody that we need to enter into a holy war against the Russians and the Chinese for the liberal world order. But just keeping it as simple as we can, Morgan, Goldman, or JP Morgan, Goldman, Citigroup, and Wells off the Davos train. And then the regional commercial banks are not interested in any of this either, because guess who also gets screwed? So who's the most powerful political lobby in the world? Not Davos. Not anymore. It's the U.S. commercial banking interests.
Okay.
Period. And it's centered around the big banks. They're the ones that decide who gets elected, who gets the money, blah, 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 who gets the loans. They're the ones that are one degree of separation from the Federal Reserve Board. Right? So they're the most powerful lobby in the world. They're the ones that actually control the purse strings for the military industrial complex and everything else. Let's not mince words here. So they're not going to go gently into that good night. I just don't buy it. And I also don't buy that while these guys may be corrupt and they may maybe corporatists, like they want an unlevel playing field in their favor, they still believe that the best way to generating wealth is through capitalism, not communism. At some point, everybody has to take a step back and go, where are we going here? Are we really going to do this? Because these people, if they get in charge, are going to make life unlivable for everybody, including me, including us, including my families and the people that I employ and all of that stuff. And when you get to that point, you know, these people are talking about making sure that we all eat bugs, that we're not allowed to have drive cars, we're not allowed to do any of this stuff. And I'm like, I can't see Jamie Dimon. By the way, one of the most disagreeable Greeks I've ever watched, and I know a lot of disagreeable Greeks, who, by the way, there's no love lost between Greeks and Germans. And I just don't see Dimon, of all people, handing over the keys to the global candy store to a bunch of German eugenicists. I just don't see it. And Klaus Schwab is a German eugenicist and a Nazi, like of Nazi heritage. These guys are just, the more you dig into these people, the creepier and the weirder and the uglier and more venal and disgusting they become. And I don't even dig that deeply anymore because I don't want to know. I've got enough information.
You bring up a really, are you familiar with, I mean, you've heard of C.S. Lewis, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, the Screwtape Letters.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking about, I don't know how I got on this, but I was thinking in at the end there, you know, after the protege, you know, Wormwood lets the soul get away and, you know, Screwtape's giving him his last final instruction or, you know, commentary, all the while basically telling him, you know, I'm going to be consuming you. And I was thinking, this is the mistake you just identified, is that when you're dealing with evil, evil is never satisfied. And so these people that have been going along with this, thinking that somehow they're going to be one of the chosen few, right? You know, it starts to fall apart. So yes. you're
because the people like Schwab don't believe in anything. They don't want to die either. They're afraid to die. That's why they believe in transhumanism. That's why they believe in this idea that they're going to upload their consciousness into people's bodies, or they're going to drink adrenochrome until they like. I you can believe as much of the stuff as you want. I don't really care, right? They're emotional vampires. They're just people. They're emotionally stunted, emotional vampires who refuse to accept their own mortality and look in the mirror and say, maybe I'm the carbon that needs to be reduced.
So let me tie up the Europe thing in a real sure. simple bag, if I'm understanding this right. Effectively, as you said, that some people are getting off the reservation.
Mm-hmm.
And so if I'm reading between the lines right, your take is that these banks are effectively pulling Powell's strings at this point. Is that, am I?
Well, I mean, I think he was put in power by these people.
Okay.
During the Trump administration to mm-hmm. affect this plan. And I think the big tell, and it's something I didn't realize until about 6 or 8 months ago. I mean, I'm not like going to sit here and claim that I understood all this stuff 5 years ago, because I didn't. But I had a patron literally ping me one day and say, dude, I want to talk to you about something. You put an idea in your head. And he started to explain. I hadn't really thought about the implications of the secured overnight funding rate and how that would decouple us from LIBOR, and how that would, that if the Fed were to raise interest rates and the euro dollar markets were to get, you know, cold, that now the Federal Reserve, now the U.S. banking system is insulated from any blowouts in LIBOR. Ending LIBOR, you should know as well as I do, who sits on the board of LIBOR? 17 European banks and J.P. Morgan's London office. Ain't any American interest, expressed in LIBOR. And, you know, I'd make a wisecrack, and I wouldn't be wrong to say that this is how the Brits have always kept control over us. Because since the day this Constitution was signed, or the day that Cornwallis, surrendered at Yorktown, that they've been trying to undermine the colonies and get them back. And so the British have always infiltrated our government. They have always kept control over our banks, and they've always. And this is why Brexit was so dangerous, because now Davos didn't have control over City of London, and now City of London may actually have to answer to the Americans. And, you know, reforming the special relationship between the US and the UK on a geopolitical front to then make Europe again subordinate to the US and the UK was the big threat to them. So, of course, why do you think they took down Boris Johnson? Why are they trying to push in Rishi Sunak? Why is the U.S. trying to push unfortunately, that PhD in geography, Liz Truss, who's literally not even an IQ 105 midwit, who's literally the dumbest person I've seen in politics outside of AOC. I mean, and she's a special kind of stupid because she's British and stupid. So that means she's arrogant about this. So I don't mince words when it comes to these people, because at this level, there's no point. So when you really it's not because I don't care. I don't, because they're trying to destroy the world. They're trying to get us involved in a freaking nuclear war with the Russians. And I'm sorry, I'm going to insult people. You know, like, oh, sue me. Fight me, bro. I don't care. So seriously, like, we got bigger worries here about whether or not whether Liz Truss is going to be angry with me for, you know, calling her arrogant and British. Like, I care. When you stop to think about this, Powell and the Fed and SOFR and all of this stuff was the mechanism by which to allow the Fed to finally break the American banking system from the European banking system. Moreover, go back to 2019, go back to the repo crisis. Zerohedge ran article after article after article saying, why is JP Morgan trying to crash the bond markets? Do you remember this? Yeah. I can't find those articles because Zerohedge's search function is awful, right? So I'd love to find like chapter and verse, like the 6 or 7 articles they wrote the entire time after Powell started to reverse course. You know, in January 2019, between then and the repo crisis of September 2019, and saying, well, why is JP Morgan, of all people, trying to destroy the bond market? You know, and they're saying, and they're going to blow out the freaking credit spreads. They're going to blow out the money markets. And lo and behold, in September 2019, they did. But here's the gig. As Martin Armstrong pointed out to everybody, Morgan led the charge for the U.S. commercial banks, some of the U.S. commercial banks, Morgan, Goldman, the ones I named earlier, Citigroup, to stop taking as collateral European debt as repo collateral. So now, after having raised interest rates and then, you know, gave a few of them back, and Europe was getting into trouble, they couldn't get dollars from the Fed.
Right.
They couldn't get dollars from the American banks anymore, because the American banks wouldn't take, you know, a German Bund at -8.8% as collateral for the repo. They just said no. So the war started. This war started 3 years ago. So should I leave my money in failing European banks? Well, the U.S. doesn't look like a credible place to put my money. And so Davos's plan has been to destroy the United States. And George Soros has made this abundantly clear that his goal is the destruction of the United States.
Yep.
So this is the layout of the land for me. And then everything just seems to be. And since I started putting this together, I've just been watching it going, that tracks. I haven't seen any data yet that tells me that the Fed is still working for Davos. What I see is the exact opposite of that, that they're doing everything imaginable to try and keep the Fed from raising rates, forcing European bond yields to rise, and then forcing credit spreads to collapse, and forcing Lagarde into the state she's in now. Oh, we're raising rates, but we're going to do QE to eternity.
Yeah. Yeah. So let me ask you this, for people, as we kind of, because I mean, this is a complicated topic.
It is.
If people are looking, what should people be paying attention to? Maybe let me ask you to combine that with where you think, you know, I'm not going to hold you to this, but where you kind of think things are headed. What should people be watching to see these things? Because it seems like
it's
right there.
Yeah, it's a really simple thing, right? Okay. Look for discontinuous events. Friday, well, actually, let's go back to Thursday. The ECB raises rates by 50 basis points. So technically now it's zero, the zero bound, or zero to -0.1%. Right, that's the range. While at the same time saying we're going to do QE to eternity, you know, to bail out Italy if we have to. This comes a day after the Draghi government that was designed to do exactly what Powell was supposed to do, which was to subordinate the Italian government after he leaves office to the European Commission by tying a whole bunch of COVID relief debt to them that they would not be able to get off their balance sheet. They wouldn't be able to leave the European Union to get rid of, because they'd be tied to the European Commission for all the money they owe them. Well, yeah, you want to leave the EU, well, you got to pay us back the $12 billion you borrowed from us, which the Italians don't have. So, or euros that they don't have. So guess what? That's what they're going to do, right? Same way that when Draghi was at the ECB, he said, you know, okay, Matteo Salvini, you can leave the euro, but you got to pay us back all your Target 2 liabilities. which would be in all your sovereign gold and then some, which was hundreds of billions of dollars. And same thing. Well, Draghi's no longer there. Giorgio Meloni and the Brothers of Italy are going to take over in less than right around two months from today, which is going to be hilarious when they say, yep, and we're leaving the euro. Sit on that and spin, which is going to be phenomenal. I can't wait for it. My people. So I'm Italian all the way back on the boat, both sides.
I'd
never see that, right? So, and New York, and a New Yorker on top of it all. So it's like, you know, dude, like, you know, half the people can't tell whether I'm, you know, whether I Anglify, whether I italified my name because they think I'm Jewish. It's hilarious. I'm like, no, I'm just from New York. Same thing.
That explains everything.
So, it's just the thing. So the, when you look at the situation, right? What you should look for now is very simple. The ECB just capitulated. That means that high net worth individuals, family offices, small funds, whatever, are all looking at the situation going, this is unsustainable. Now you watch for capital flight out of Europe. It's not really difficult. And what would capital flight out of Europe look like here in the United States? It would look like a rising Dow and rising U.S. bond yields, which is exactly what we saw on Thursday and Friday. The Dow rallied and the 10-year moved up 25 basis points. Now, that also allowed Lagarde, a lot of people to front run Lagarde on the German 10-year and, you know, and whatnot, and gave her some breathing room because now the yield on a bunch of euro debt, you know, also drops because it's all because those spreads still haven't blown out yet. Like between U.S. and German debt, you know, there people are obsessed with inter-European bond spreads, which you should really be looking at is the difference between U.S. and German bond spreads. Because when the market says it prefers U.S. debt over German debt, that's when all of Europe collapses. Because the German Bund is the European equivalent, is the safe haven trade for Europe, right?
Yeah.
So, like, that's the way I'm looking at it. And yeah, there's some Swiss franc, you know, issuance in there, and you know, you can look at those spreads as well, but that's as far as I can, my brain can look at this point. I can go US German bond spreads, SOFR versus 1 month LIBOR, right? The rate on SOFR versus 1 month LIBOR is, I think, also a very important one. But the big one for most people on a day-to-day basis is just look at the Dow. If the Dow is holding up while we move into recession and trade sideways, well, that's international capital flowing into the Dow. The Dow is the biggest, most liquid equity pool. Right. For, you know, you can't put it in the S&P 500. You can't put it into the NASDAQ. You got to put it into the Dow, traditionally speaking. I mean, yeah, there would be some other sectors that people will put in. And then the same thing with U.S. debt. And so, yeah, we might get an inversion of the yield. We have gotten an inversion of the yield curve, and all sorts of weird things will happen that way. But that the Fed's not worried about that. The Fed has a mission, and the mission is kill the ECB and kill the offshore dollar markets, because the offshore euro dollar shadow banking system has always previously controlled Fed policy, which is why so many people always go, yeah, the Fed will pivot the minute they try to raise rates.
Yeah.
But what if they aren't going to do that this time? What if they have the tools in place? The reverse repo facility, the foreign repo facility, SOFR, this, all of these things that they put in place over the last 5 years. What if also the Fed has said we have to have a recession in order to save the country and the currency and the banking system? What if we have to do?
So many of these people are screaming and yelling and kicking their heels. I mean, it's kind of ironic, as you said, you look at this stuff and you really see, I think you said this in the beginning, which side people are on. You know, there's a gal we listen to who's kind of an insider, but she says, you know, people start pulling their pants down.
Here's one for you. What bothers me is that you've got so many people whose reputations now depend on the idea that the Fed's the bad guy. My reputation is I go where the truth is. After 5 years of doing this now, I don't care. I'm going to continue to go where the truth is. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I'll own it and I'll move on. And I've been asking everybody for the last 13 months since the Fed raised the reverse repo payout rate by 5 basis points and drained $1.5 trillion worth of base money from the Eurodollar system. Hey, over 3 months. Hey, you think maybe the Fed's off the reservation? You know, it's funny, Emerson. I know Powell's not this kind of guy. But I know that when he was last summoned to the Biden White House to talk about inflation, remember this? about, yes. I don't know, about 2 months ago, right before the 50 basis point rate hike. Mm-hmm. You know that Biden went in there and tried to talk tough to him. And Powell just looked right at him and said, you shut up. It's almost jello time.
Yeah.
You don't set policy. Like, this had been me. I'd been like, shut up. You, this is jello time. And then you, Obama, come over here. Let's talk. If you look at me sideways, it's 75 basis points. If you mock me, it's 100 on Thursday. If you don't go out there and say to everybody that I'm not the greatest Fed chairman in the history of the world, it's 150. Because I will break your master overnight. I don't care, which is what he should have done. But what he's doing now is just gently leading everybody up to that 4% mark and just boiling Europe in its own oil thereof, while the Russians on the other side turn up the heat and say, oh, yeah, by the way, you don't have any energy either.
I can listen to you all day. If people want, I'll end on this because I know you got work to do.
Mm-hmm.
But you mentioned about seeking truth. And, I was always a guy who really just ignored. I was happy. I mean, my firm was doing fine. We're building assets because, rates go down, everything, where else are you going to put your money?
Right.
I mean, it worked for so long.
Right.
But when you finally start seeking and looking and honestly, like you said, detaching from old ways of thinking, then all of a sudden the world opens up and you start to see things differently. And these events take on different meanings. And I will tell you, on one hand, it's a bit of a burden,
because
I've got clients who are all different places of politically and where they see and where they're willing to go with this. But I have a responsibility to try and help protect them the best I can.
Of course.
But at the same time, it's refreshing because I've met guys like Craner, like you. Russell Napier is another one I really like over in Scott. I mean, just smart people who aren't afraid to say what they feel because they're not worried about getting cut off from some revenue stream, from some big bank. It's so nice to talk to people who aren't owned.
Well, I mean,
never had any idea.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the other thing is we have an obligation to our clients, and I have a couple thousand patrons now. I have an obligation to them every day. Right.
So, Tom, if people want to get a hold of you, where's the best place for them to go?
Best place to go is my blog over tomluongo.me. There you can get links to the Patreon if you want to become a member. I have two tiers worth of service. One's $4. It's basically for the private blogs and the private market reports, and also the community channel that I have, and $12 a month for the newsletter, which is a retail investor style, classic retail investor newsletter with basically a stock portfolio design to kind of make it relatively easy to chart your path through all this. And then you can follow me on Twitter, where I'm, if you liked what you heard today, my Twitter feed's even spicier. And that's a TFL1728.
Awesome. And I will say, full transparency, I know that's a big thing nowadays. I'm a recent subscriber, and I will tell you, that's just in the short time I've been a member, excellent value. I mean, I really look forward to your material. So
yeah, that's how we hooked up, actually. You sent me a private DM on Patreon. I'm like, dude, you're giving me money. Of course I'll come on your podcast. Like, I also believe in paying things forward. I remember when I was just starting out, like, I got the minute I got invited onto any show whatsoever that gave me a chance, I was like, yeah, thank you. You're awesome. And then I get now that my star is starting to rise a little bit, I want other people in this space to, I want to give them the exposure they can as well. I mean, it's just the way, this is how you do it. This is how you build a community. So
let's end on that, because I was telling my wife this just yesterday, I'm really grateful. She's the one that turned me on to Zerohedge. I'm really grateful because it's opened up. I do feel like I have this community and I've got people I can really listen to and learn from in an industry in particular. I mean, I've been doing this since, 92. I got my first broker license.
Sure.
And it's just been a lot of the same noise all these years. I just thought that was normal. And I just feel like now I'm in such a better place to help my people that have entrusted me with their money. So
yeah.
God bless your family.
No, that's what we're here for. I mean, we have to push this forward, and it's funny. I feel that same responsibility to my patrons on a day-to-day basis. Like, it's the same kind of thing. It's exactly the same process, right? You want to constantly, give people information that they can act on, or that will at least de-stress them and make them, and so they can go and they can start to synthesize what they're seeing so that they can then make better judgments. Even if all they do at the end of the day, they just check in with me every week or every couple of posts or whatever and go, oh yeah, okay, they're still saying the same thing. Everything's fine. Okay, cool. I can go back to running my small business, you know, cutting my grass, playing with my children, and getting some sleep at night. Because the worst thing about this is that what they're trying to do is keep us in a constant state of anxiety where we don't understand what's going on. And then we act out of fear, and we abreact out of fear. And that's the last place you want to be. You want to be you want to be settled in your idea about how this is going to play out and have at least some semblance of what's, you know, what's going to happen, and leave the real anxiety stuff that keeps you up at night. Leave that to me. I'll figure it out. And then I'll tell you, and then you make your life a little easier. I won't sleep at night, and I'll smoke too many cigars and drink too much coffee.
Perfect.
It is what it is. I'm okay with it.
Tom, but man,
I sleep better at night now than I ever have. So there you go.
Thanks so much. It's been great. I could talk to you all day.
I appreciate it, Emerson. You be well, and best to your clients and your family and everybody else. And we'll talk soon.
Emerson Fersh is a registered representative with and securities offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA, SIPC. Advisor services offered through LPL Financial, a registered investment advisor and separate entity from Capital Investment Advisors. The opinions voiced in this podcast are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations for any individual. To determine which strategies or investments may be suitable for you, consult the appropriate qualified professional prior to making a decision. The guest speakers and the companies they represent are not affiliated with or endorsed by LPL Financial or Capital Investment Advisors. Individual tax and legal matters should be discussed with your tax or legal expert. Economic forecasts set forth may not develop as predicted, and there can be no guarantee that strategies promoted will be successful. All performance referenced is historical and is no guarantee of future results. All indices are unmanaged and may not be invested into directly. There is no assurance that the techniques and strategies discussed are suitable for all investors or will yield positive outcomes. The purchase of certain securities may be required to affect some of the strategies. Investing involves risks, including possible loss of principal.